I have a couple of the Rifts role-playing game Ultimate Books. Such a crazy game. Such a crazy game. I forgot I had one, and then I bought another. So that's why I have two. That was on me. And I have the Game Master's Guide. And I have a few other Rifts resources here and there. I know I've got Vampire Kingdoms floating around, which is their first source book. I do want to run it. I really do. I don't know if I'm going to run it with Savage Worlds rules, though. I do have that conversion. And I'm interested in Savage Worlds right now, so that might happen. This is a dead game that came across my radar at a half-price bookstore. This is called Alpha Omega. It's a post-apocalyptic game, but humanity is on the rebound. But just as, you know, their technology is high and they're taking back Earth from the hellscape it got turned into, and they're working on rehabilitating it, all of a sudden a big cosmic brawl between two forces that, when they visited Earth before, they became the angels and demons of mythology, are coming back for another round. But now humanity can fight back. It's an interesting concept, very ambitious. The company had a lot of things going for it in terms of their vision, and then it just died, vanished. I haven't been able to find out exactly why. I suspect all kinds of things, from financial mishandling. Once people can't get paid, you know, they tend to fall pretty quickly after that. So, but I don't know. Could have been infighting inside. Could have been a lot of things. I just simply don't know. My collection of Torg books. The only thing I don't have with Torg that really stops me from running it is I don't have the drama deck. I know there is one. And I know a play, I'm sure I could download it and print it off myself, but I'm not as interested in doing that. I'd like to find one. And I know my game store just recently bought a person's collection, or they're on the cusp of doing it, who has an intact Torg box set with the cards. So I have hopes of getting that, and I would like to run it. Torg's a fascinating world. It's the again, one of the more interesting West End game worlds, I find. The idea of Earth derping along okay, and then all of a sudden all these other realities crash into it and turn world into just a mess. But you, your characters, are the Storm Knights. You can learn different powers and abilities from these different worlds and use them to fight back. That's pretty cool in my mind. I like that idea. So, as a result, Torg is something I'm deeply interested in, and I've collected a lot of those books because somebody must have turned their collection at a half-price bookstore, and my store had a lot of this stuff, so I just collected it a little bit at a time. Oh, Lord. Whew. That's a lot of stuff, you know? Yeah, all kinds of the various Torg books. And I know I saw Nile Empire up there somewhere too. So that's got to go in with it. Then I also got Gearkrieg, which I think is an alternate Earth. Something more World War II, but went more into steampunk, I believe? I don't know, it was also at a half-price bookstore. I saw it and I'm like, oh, this could be fun. At the very least, it'll make for a good video. Where it'll go from there, I don't know. I really don't have any idea. So, then we've got, yeah, I've got African Theater Gearkrieg. I've got a collection of them. Then we've got Battletech. I've got a couple of Battletech books. Battletech was kind of my go-to for what to do when half the guys can't show up. We just play Battletech. And I tried to get a campaign going where the players were mercenaries with their own battle mechs, and they would be put into a given situation and try to take the objectives with promises of repairs and ammunition reloads if they succeeded, as well as improving their lot. So, never really did anything with it, despite the fact that I've got, I think I have the Mech Warrior role-playing game too. Agony. An epic role-playing game set in the Twilight Realms. This is another half-price books. $8 for a hardcover role-playing game manual. Is it any good? Couldn't tell you. I honestly don't know. It's got nice art. The interior layout looks tight. It has potential. It might be very good. I don't know. I haven't run it. I haven't really read it. There's just like mixed in with my World of Darkness games. There's one that's not a World of Darkness game. Oh, what was it called? I mixed it in, but I can't remember what it was called. But anyhow, it's the idea of playing an immortal from Highlander. That you can only die if you get your head cut off. Yeah. Don't know when I'll ever get around to that one. But I like Highlander. At least in the concept. So I'm not sure how good the game is. Maybe someday we'll find out together. This is my Twilight 2000 section. This is the second edition box set. This is the 2.3 or 2.2 version. Again, half price book sale. I got a couple of the modules, Gateway to the Spanish Main, the U.S. Army Vehicle Guide, and the Free City of Krakow. And, I have... Where's that first edition? There it is. So we keep those together. Interesting world. Honestly, out of all of the Facebook groups that I belong to, the Twilight 2000 group is the most active and fun. It's just all these guys who love this game, and we're military guys who have insights that are fascinating to listen to. And even a couple of the former writers have chimed in, like Frank Frey. Awesome. Princess Bride, the role-playing game. Played it once to not-so-good results. Have very strong hopes of playing it with my new group. And having a lot more fun with it. Hopefully. Savage Worlds Deluxe. Of course, this is the gateway. From this, you can go on to all the other sordid Savage Worlds books. And there's quite a few of them. I'm interested in the Ripper's campaign world. The superheroes might be good. I don't know. Haven't read it. I do have the Rifts core book and the GM's book, though. Those will have to get added to that collection when I find them. Hee-hee. Then we have Warhammer 40K Wrath and Glory, the new one by Cubicle 7. Scratch and dented, but it's readable. I've been watching Warhams, a bunch of people from the If the Emperor Had a Text-to-Speech Device. If you never saw that, I highly recommend it. It's very funny. They've been playing this game, and I fell in love with the rules. It's a narrative version of Warhammer 40K, where the version that was made by Fantasy Flight tried to simulate reality much more, less interested in more narrative elements. So it's a sea change of difference in their focuses. I'd like to try this with my new group. My old group can handle the Fantasy Flight just fine. The simulation works for them. And Blades in the Dark, another new one that everybody I knew online was constantly hyping this game up. And finally, I had a chance to get it at the Scratch and Dent sale, and I'm like, okay, let's take a look. After looking at it, it's fantastic. There's all kinds of elements in there that I can use for a variety of games, so yeah, I'm glad I got it. Even if I don't run that one anytime soon, it's going to make my other games better, and that gets me excited. And then I got Fang Shui Shadow Fist role-playing. I'm not sure what version this is. I just saw it at Half Price Books, and I'm like, this sounds kind of gonzo, and I remember hearing people recommending it. After looking through it, it's kind of strange. To me, it reads a lot like Exalted. Not in the setting, but the idea that there are these alternate Earths, and there are these energy sources that you're trying to capture, seem to me to be a lot like the various shrines and essence sources in Exalted. So there could be some definite similarities there. And then I ended up getting Golden Comeback, also at the Half Price Books, as a source book. So again, I might be interested in running this at some point in the near future. That, I hope, makes it onto my list of games that I run in 2021. Spycraft, which is, I believe, Modern D20. Not likely to run it, but I think I got it with a collection that I bought. Mostly I use it for resource material for... I can talk today. For Top Secret SI that I intend to run at some point. And then I have the WWF Adventure game. Not WWE, WWF, back in the day. Might be really cool to get a game of that running, but it's not something I would like to run for a long campaign and be the commissioner of. It's not that good for that, I find. But, you know, it's got some elements that make it intriguing to play a game that tries to simulate a wrestling game with all of the beating down that your character can take and comebacks and, you know, pro wrestling is weird anyhow. So, the biggest thing I'm going to need to clear out is there's just a pile of different people's role-playing game materials. Not necessarily my books and things. Oh, although I do have the D&D starter set with Demogorgon from Stranger Things. And I just saw a core book for that that has to go in there. So yeah, out of all this stuff, I have to try to get some room so that I have room to take those books that were all sticking out of the end of the bookshelf and be able to put all that back. Can I do it? I don't know. I really don't. I don't want to have to end up putting it all back. Some of these books, like these Warhammer books, kind of are an anchor around my neck because I have to store them. And that's just one bookshelf. That one's even messier. But that one's a little bit easier to look at because that section there is all Star Wars. That section is all Star Wars. Mostly a D6, little D20, some Saga stuff, and none of the new stuff from Fantasy Flight Games. I've been told it's really good. The books are big and expensive, and I haven't been able to collect them yet. So I'm interested, just haven't gotten there yet. Shadowrun. From 1st edition on up to 6th edition, I've got a little bit of everything in there. It's a system that I've loved. It's a world that I've loved, and I have played from time to time. But it takes a lot to get invested in doing a real campaign because one-shots, the characters are too involved for one-shots. Even grabbing a template and going, it's still a bit involved. So especially trying to teach a group new sets of rules and things. I know they've gotten more streamlined over different editions, but still, there's work to be done there. I have my little Palladium corner here that is not Rifts. Although I think there's still a Rifts book or two in there. I have Gygax's Living Fantasy, one of his better reference books. A couple of Blood Bowl source books, even. Odd stuff. A couple of Magitek game, Amazing Engine. Car Wars. I have a metagame 2, Dragons of Underneath. Terrible game. So I had half-price books. It was practically free. I got it, and I'm like, I'll never do anything with this. My Grimtooth Traps books right here. Fun. Decent collection there. Then I've got my Kobolds Ate My Baby books. Kobolds Ate My Baby is a great beer and pretzels game, just for fun. Nothing too serious, nothing that, let me just kind of scooch this around, nothing that you, you know, feel all that invested in, but just fun to take your little furry weirdos and go out and try to steal babies. This, one of the more valuable things in my collection, not as far as cost, but Matt Finch's A Quick Primer to Old School Gaming. This was given to me by the Targa, the Traditional Adventurer Role-Playing Game Association. Gave me this basically because I stopped at their booth and talked to them. And this is a fantastic guide for bringing people into old school gaming. I might actually read this for my players before we start that Dungeons & Dragons game. Because, like I said, it is a sea change in difference in your approach to playing. I also have one of the old Arduin Grimoires. This is the third book. But I got it at an auction at GameholeCon and they said this is probably just a reproduction. Probably not authentic. Not that it matters, it's Gonzo stuff that I don't ever really see myself using. But just something else that's new and neat. Like so many things that I've got, just looking for new and neat. Riddle Rooms, Dungeon Dilemmas, this is an excellent book. More useful than Grimtooth's Dungeon of Doom. The puzzles and things in there are kind of cool. These are all like miscellaneous things. Steve Jackson's Murphy's Rules compilation. Epic Tavern Builder from RPG Crate. I do have a Traveler book, but that's just the charts and tables. Really not very useful for much. Fantastic Treasures, Roll Aids books. Sometimes good reading to give you a little inspiration. A Harn map. Pathfinder Player's Guide. Odds and Ends, Dragons, Roll Aids. Fantastic Treasures, Roll Aids. That's Fantastic Treasures 2. So I've got both of those. Gaming Frontiers magazine, you know, just weird stuff. Masters of Roleplaying magazines. Couple of old classic role players from the GURPS magazines. Wanted to collect those. I know they're all digital now, but, you know, it's nice to have these collections sometimes. There were some neat ideas. Oh, the old classic Rogues Gallery. Also gotten at half-price books for next to nothing. Which is cool, because they had stats for some of the more interesting name characters in miniatures for Star Wars. Oh, these are, lest you think these are the new ones. This is, they did a Micro Machines Star Wars set a long time ago, and I looked at that and I go, oh wow, these could be used as miniatures for Star Wars role-playing game. So I got a bunch of sets of these. And are they good for that? Not really. They're not all that useful. But, you know, having a bunch of stormtroopers for that game, or rebel pilots, or whatever kind of XPs you want to use, is better than not having them. So, there's that. So. But yeah, I mean, all kinds of cast-offs. That's how I magpie my collection. Things like Pokey Thulu. From John Ross and John Kovalik doing the art for this. And now I'm going to have a book slide. 70 Maxims of Maximally Effective Mercenaries. This also came with the Kickstarter for Planet Mercenary. I'm a little scared of all this stuff coming down. I really am. This is the card selection for the Saga system of Dragonlance. I understand these are rare, hard to find, so I probably should do something better with these. But this was a way of, instead of using dice, using cards to resolve a Dungeons & Dragons game that they came out with. It wasn't very good. There's a good reason why this didn't last very long, but still one of those novelties that I have in my collection. Oops. And Rift Sourcebook 3 Mindworks, and there's a Torg book, and there's another Torg book, Tharkold, and Orosh. Yeah. I'm really ready to do Torg at some point in the very near future. Some things from Half Pro. This is the basic game for the Dragonlance thing. This was a collection of games on Free RPG Day. Little one-page games, or one or two or three or four page. Very cool. I thought those were really neat. There's a couple of really good ideas on playing around with the idea of what is a role-playing game. Shadowrun First Edition. There's that Vampire Kingdoms book I was thinking of. Tramp Freighters from Star Wars D6. Back from... This is something I got for next to nothing. Dry Erase Grid. That I'll probably be taking with me to some games. Got that on an after school was out clearance special, which is, you really got to look for those if you're going to be collecting a lot of games and stuff. Vampire Quickstarter for the new Requiem rules. Yeah. Promotional thing I got from Gen Con 2001. Star Children, Build the Generation role-playing game. Game about playing characters caught aliens who come to Earth to enjoy the sex, drugs, and rock and roll revolution. There's the Rift Savage Worlds book, so I really got to consolidate a lot of these things. But that should help clarify a lot of this collection, because some of this stuff is just unacceptable in how Southern Cross, Robotech, more Palladium stuff. Original art by Terry Pavlett. I get something from him every time I see him at a con. So, Legends of the Lance, a couple of these magazines from 1998, spring and summer collection. So, I love these newsletters. They really were kind of useful for adding on to the whole mystique of the world by making a living, breathing creature. The Immortal Storm adventure. I will never run an Immortals game. I'm pretty sure that's never going to get touched more than I just did. Random binders, always fun. Here I have another battle mat. This is my Hex battle mat for outdoor encounters or playing GURPS. This one I've had for a long time. It's got cigarette burns in it. It's not in the greatest of shape, but it's still serviceable, and it's got character, right? Right? I think so. Little Wizards, a cool little rules light game about magic. Saw that, kind of melted my heart, and I brought it home to my wife, another continual light, and said, see, we could run this, and she liked it. She thought the idea was kind of cool, so. Kingdoms of Kalamar, Sourcebook Special Preview, Talislanta art, because I had a friend who thought Talislanta was really cool. Still have a friend who thinks Talislanta is really cool. I gotta, just in case he sees this. I think Talislanta is cool, but it's fatally flawed. And not because there are no elves. I'm fine with that. I just think that balance is kind of a joke, and the resolution system is kind of hot. Garbage isn't the right word. It's never more than just barely adequate, I think. There's much better systems that have done gaming better, I think. So, Essentials Kit, again, did a review on this. They had some neat stuff in there that really made it a pretty good value all in all. And we have some Exalted books and more Torg books. The Land Below, Possibility Chalice. Yeah, Half Price Bookstore was really good to me with my Torg collection. Full Moon Draw, The Godnet. So yes, when it comes to replaying Torg, I can run a pretty good game. I really just want that deck. That's really all that's holding me back. Riddles. This is a fun little resource. A lot of people hate riddles. I'm not fond of coming up with riddles, so something like that can be useful for little one-offs. I just have to keep reminding myself, never make it anything all that important. Oh. Interesting. Queen's Harvest, an introductory for Dungeons & Dragons. I forgot I had this. I may have to. I'm sure this is for first characters, right? First level? If this is an introductory, I would expect this to be for first level characters. This is best enjoyed after playing the adventure module B11 King's Festival. Oh. Okay, we'll have to keep an eye out for that. I like the idea of continuous adventures, one feeding into another, so... yeah, that's cool. And on here we come to a lot of the odds and ends that I got from... the RPG crates that I've collected. So, some useful resources, maps, and... kinds of odds and ends. Another gift from them were all of these tokens. Got bags full of tokens. Many of them are for Pathfinder. I don't really use tokens much if I have a 3D miniature for it, but it's nice to cover in the gaps. This one was fun, though. From JasonBraun.com. Jason Braun. He sold me this Otyug coloring book with a brown marker. Because Otyugs are brown, and they're in refuse, so you're only going to use brown. I thought that was funny. So I bought it because I thought it was hilarious. He presented it well. He was very well spoken. I had left with good feelings towards him. So, yeah, Jason Braun, you're awesome. Keep doing great art. So, after the top shelf and all that bric-a-brac that I have to sort through, I got most of my box sets here. And, you know, there's something special about box sets. Some of them are some of the most valuable artifacts in gaming. I mean, I would love to have a box set with the wood grain OD&D, or the white box OD&D would be great. I don't. But instead, I've got some nice things. The Forgotten Realms campaign setting. Ruins of Mithranor box set, which is kind of a mini campaign in and of itself. Tales of the Comet! One of the craziest games ever. But you know, I might end up having to run that too. See how this group does. AD&D castle set. It actually, I believe, had a fold-out castle that you could make, papercraft. It's, yeah. The Ravenloft box set. That one's actually stuffed with a lot of the Van Richten's guides too, which does help it from crumpling. That's can be useful. The Dark Sun box set. I know a lot of people really like the Dark Sun. As a matter of fact, I even have a mini Dark Sun box set too, but that's much more that's much easier to read. Ghostbusters, I just finished that, so that's got its home here. Top Secret SI, I do want to run that at some point in the very near future. The D&D Gazetteer, Dawn of the Emperors, Thedas, and Alphatia. In my mind, some of the best places to start in the world of Mystara, the world of basic Dungeons & Dragons that they spelled out, so I've got that. The D&D starter set, only thing missing with that, the actual basic set of rules, which are downloadable from Wizards, but I loaned them to somebody and they never got them back, so I'm kind of sad about that. Forever World books, the Forever World game. That one's a weird one. That one's another one of those games that came out, nice box set, it looked good, died before they could put out the stuff they promised they were going to put out. Rollmaster box sets. I think that one has a few extra books in there, too. That was another find at Half Price Bookstore, and though it cost me dearly, it was a nice set. I also have Grimtooth's Lair. This one was actually sold to me by the folks who were selling Grimtooth stuff, but this is actually a knockoff. It was not made with their permission, so they basically sued the guy, and he just turned over his stuff, and they made it for themselves, which was kind of funny. The Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Starter Set. This is something that I will be running this year. I've wanted to do this for a while, so a couple of Star Wars D6. That's going to have to go up there again. The Wrath and Glory Starter Set. This is how I'm going to introduce my players to Wrath and Glory. The Planescape box set. Yeah, those of you with OCD, I apologize. They are all scrambled. I'm going to reorganize those before I'm done. The Council of Worms box set. This one, along with Tale of the Comet, some people think were really not very good. It was different. It was a different time. It was a different thrust that they were aiming for. And even more RPG crate stuff. But, you know, sometimes wouldn't want to play a cool dragon. It was just a weird, it was a strange campaign. The Downtown Militarized Zone for Shadowrun actually gave alternate combat rules that we ended up liking better than the rules for first edition Shadowrun, so we started incorporating these into our game. Kind of neat, but really what this was supposed to be was a tactical tabletop war game set in the Shadowrun universe. Battletech FASA, that goes with all the Battletech stuff I have there. Also, another edition of the Battletech game. I think that actually belongs to a friend of mine, so if he ever sees this video and wants it, he can come back and get it. It would clear up a little space in my shelf, at least. First Quest, a nice little collection of adventures for 2nd edition Dungeons & Dragons. Denver City of Shadows for Shadowrun. I think this was done in 2nd edition. The Battle System, Advanced Dungeons & Dragons box set. It was pretty terrible. I mean, I've found better, more streamlined systems for running mass combat. I just don't really have any use for that, but it came with one of the collections that I bought out. Star Wars Invasion of Theed. This was the D20 Star Wars intro box set. Again, it came with a collection. Gamma World box set. This was, I think, third edition. So, yeah, something I've got. The Dark Strider campaign. This was my best friend's passion project. He wanted to run that game for us so badly. And it just... We started and it just kind of fell apart. It was... You had to really be in on that world in order to get into it, so... And then this one... Hey, Star Trek The Next Generation role-playing game. Starfleet Academy box set. I'm not a Trekkie. I'm honest with you. I thought that was a self-contained game, but it's really just a Source box set. But if you're looking for data and lore on, you know, what goes into people who want to eventually be on camera in a Star Trek The Next Generation as part of Starfleet, those kind of things are really useful to learn about. So even if I never play that role-playing game, you know, it's good reading material. About all I got to say about that. Then I've got my various modules, the dungeon magazines that I've collected. Mostly I've only collected in collections of dungeon magazines so that I can run a continuous story path. Primarily the Age of Worms story path, which is one of the last things that Paizo did when they had control of Dungeon Magazine. Otherwise, I collected a lot of Dragon magazines. I'm not going to say I have the whole collection. It does help, though, when you have the CD that has the first 250 episodes. So, unfortunately, I lost a number due to a flood in the basement here a while ago. So, now that everything is digital, it takes some of the specialness away from the new content they put out. I miss the old magazine, honestly. I really do. A lot of these are third-party modules. So these are all fodder for games that I can run at just about any time. And I think going into a lot of con games, I probably will draw more on those rather than things that I create for myself, simply because I have this legacy of stuff that I really do want to use. I don't collect this stuff to be a dragon sitting on its hoard. I plan on using this stuff. So, fortunately, my wife has been inspiring me to use this stuff, darn it, rather than, you know, just keep cranking out your own stuff. And it's brilliant. I might not have done it if she hadn't done that, so it's actually, you know, really good idea. Then I have the 4th edition Gamma World box set. That was at giveaway prices at Half Price Bookstore. I got it, took a look at it, and it's 4th edition D&D set with Gamma World, but here's the thing that ticked me off about it. It's based on abilities and powers that you only have access to on collectible trading cards that you get in blind packs. That is the dumbest idea I've ever heard of. I mean, if you're greedy and you're going for raw money, that's one thing. No, that is it. That's the only thing that you hope that this is going to generate more money. I hope that might have been the straw that broke the camel's back on 4th edition and told them to knock it off. Because that's just garbage. Although the game itself doesn't look like it's terrible. Dungeon Fantasy, that's the GURPS answer to Dungeons & Dragons, with all the core things that are available in GURPS just consolidated down to fit into a D&D campaign setting. For somebody like me who really likes GURPS, I intend to use this when I introduce my players to GURPS. Because it is a sample size set rather than looking at these huge books that you can do anything with. Star Warriors, that was a D6 Star Wars game, so Star Wars the role-playing game from West End Games. Fun thing, that was the space combat. Eventually, the elements from that got put into the regular role-playing game around 2nd Edition, Ultimate 2nd Edition. But this gave counters and things and made it a tactical combat game that was interwoven in with the role-playing game. Was it good? Considering when your ship gets blown up, it's usually really bad for the character inside. We never really used it very much because the risks of getting killed in a starfighter like that are very real. So most of our fights that took place in Star Wars usually took place, well, the group was in some big, well-armored ship, like a stock light freighter that was juiced up because the smuggler was really taking care of it. So it meant that the whole group was very rarely in imminent danger unless they all were, and then they could all use their skills together to try to survive. So which honestly I think is the best approach for that kind of a game. And then Everway, another game that I picked up as an opportunity of choice. It's a very dreamy, weird game where the events of it take place as guided by like tarot cards with very surreal images on them, and you interpret what's going on through those. It's odd and strange, but honestly, I think it might unlock a new level of storytelling in our group, so I'm kind of looking forward to doing that with my Ghostbusters group. I think they might have fun with that. These jumbo playing cards are bought for effect, so I do. I want to use those when we're playing Savage Worlds, and if we ever play Deadlands, so that when I lay them out in front of people for their initiative, I can see them easily from across the table. So it's a nod to me and my frailties. A friend of mine gave me these box sets. He doesn't play games anymore. He says, I just have these lying around. So I've got the Dungeons & Dragons, the Dragon's Den, Dungeons & Dragons, the Goblin's Lair, and the Dungeons & Dragons box set board game, which basically were a snapshot of the Dungeons & Dragons game packaged so that families looking to buy board games could take a look at those and go, hey, this is Dungeons & Dragons, but it's a board game. And it very much was intended as a gateway to get you into the game itself. Did it succeed? Was it successful at that? I couldn't tell you, but actually they're pretty nicely made products. And something I definitely need to be doing a review on. Then, finally, got my GURP stuff down there. Free and clear so that I can always get access to it. I love referencing the various books in GURPS. I do. I've never stopped. Even though I don't get to run the game very often, I love to have that stuff on hand so that I can play those games if the opportunity presents itself, but also so that I can reference all the fantastic things that GURPS has consolidated and laid out for people. I don't have a hard time converting things from one element to another, so I really do love GURPS and having all of these books. It's just handy for me. Not a lot of duplication there. Most of those are all of the things that I've ever had much of an interest in, spread between 3rd and 4th edition. Mostly just the 4th edition core books. Everything else is primarily 3rd, but realistically, not that much changed. So, it's still all very valid. So, other than that, there's a couple binders with some character sheets and some loose materials here and there. Couple of boxes that I intend to use for storage for different things, but I think that is most of what I... Oh, no, there's a little bit more here and there. Because I have the, I forgot about you, the second edition Paranoia box set. Got this at a Goodwill. Thrift store diving is awesome, especially when it pays off for you. So that's cool. And again, that was the box and a bit extra, some other box set that was stuck in there. And yeah, there's a couple of novels and things in here. This is the kind of stuff that I'm going to, including some of my wife's, a couple of things in here that I'm going to have to go through to thin out just so I have room for this and room ultimately to expand. There's a couple of other projects that I'm interested in looking towards. And I need to get some more room for that, and rather than, well, I have a finite amount of space, so I can't just keep adding on bookshelves everywhere in this basement. There'll be no room for anything, and I'll have to eventually take out the furnace. I mean, this all gets a lot easier when my son moves out of the house, because his room is going into a library, I'm telling you this right now. No, I'm just kidding. But, just a joke. But, yeah. So this is what I have to work with, and I have to make this work and get things ready for the next games that are coming up. So, yeah, that's the work I have ahead of me. So thanks for sharing some of this labor with me. And when next we meet, maybe I'll have neater shelves and can show off things in a better light. So, till then, thanks for joining me. I'll see you next time. Farewell.